Now let's move on to elementary matrices. These are the matrices that will implement the elementary row operations. Elementary operations are row operations. You are swapping two rows, or you are adding a multiple of a row to another. So basically what you're doing is taking linear combinations of the rows of a matrix. And from the row picture of matrix multiplication, you know that taking linear combinations of a matrix on the right in a product is the same as multiplying by a matrix on the left. I'm using the row picture to implement the row operation. So each elementary operation is a multiplication on the left by some matrix, which I'm going to call EI, which is the elementary operator. It's called the elementary matrix. So I have to keep doing multiple operations. So each operation is a multiplication. So I'll have a series of them. I'll take the matrix A, maybe I swap two rows, or maybe add a multiple, so that is implemented by this, and something else implemented by the second one, and all the way I have k such operations, and all k of them when multiplied will give me some matrix E, that is the product of the matrices. And finally what I'll get is an upper triangular matrix, which is the REF. So I haven't specified what these guys are. So starting with this, we had the augmented matrix. We want to subtract the first row from the second row. The second row here will have to be the current second row minus the first row. So the first row of the product is the same as the first row in the original matrix, because first row we didn't do anything about. So first row is a linear combination of the rows here. What kind of linear combination? One of the first row and zero of the second row. Nothing of the second row, one of the first row, and that is the first row of the green matrix here. The second one is more interesting. I have to subtract the first row from the second one. Minus 1 times the first row and 1 times the second row. Let's look at a few more of them. Suppose I wanted to swap the second and third row of a 3 by 3 matrix, okay? So R3 and R2, I want to swap them. How will I do this? So what I'll do is I'll write an elementary matrix like this. What does it say? In the product, what will happen is that I'll have as the first row, 1 of the first row, 0 of the second row, and 0 of the third row. That means the product will have just the first row of whatever matrix I put here. I'll have the first row of the A matrix in my product. In the second row, I take 0 of the first row, 0 of the second row, 1 of the third row. So the second row of the product will have the third row of A. And in the third row, I'll take 0 of the first row, 1 of the second row, and 0 of the third row. So in the third row of the product, I'll have the second row of A. So basically, I swapped row number 2 and 3. In fact, if you look at the elementary matrix here, elementary operator here, what I did was to take the identity matrix and swap the second and third row in the identity matrix. That is exactly what it's going to do to any matrix. Now, what's the determinant of this guy? Remember, if I swap two rows, determinant changes sign, then I get minus 1. Now, if I scale the second row by a factor of 4, what I'm planning to do is to replace in the product the second row by 4 times the current second row. So I'll write the elementary matrix like that. Now let's multiply this by A and see what happens. In the product, I'll have 1 of the first row, 0 of the second row, 0 of the third row. So the first row is the same. The second row, I'll have 0 of the first row, 4 times the second row, and 0 of the third row. So the second row gets scaled by 4. The third row, 0 of the first row, 0 of the second row, 1 of the third row. So third row stays put. So that is the implementation of scaling. Now a more complicated one. Subtract 3 times the first row from the third. Okay, so R3 is going to be replaced by minus 3R1 plus R3. So this is my elementary matrix. Again, I'm multiplying A on the left by this elementary matrix. 1 times the first row, 0 times the second row, 0 times the third row. The first row is the same. Similarly, the second row is the same. Nothing happens to the second row. But the third row, I take minus 3 times the first row and 0 times the second row and 1 of the third row of the matrix A, and that is going to be the third row of the product. So this guy implements exactly that, minus 3R1 plus R. You can actually see this in the matrix. That's the beauty of the row picture. So what it does to the identity matrix is going to do to any matrix. So that's why we could just take the identity matrix and swap two rows and say that, okay, that's what it's going to do to anything. So what you can say is that the elementary matrices all differ from the identity matrix by just one row operation. Here it was a swap. Here this was a scaling. Here this was some other elementary operation, which is 3 times the first row subtracting from the third row. So if you ignore this guy in gray, because we're not going to use that, we can say that the third elementary operation does not change the determinant. The first operation does change the determinant. It's a swapping of two rows. It's a sign change. You can say that the elementary operators will have determinants plus or minus 1, not counting the second one. I'm not counting this guy. Now you have to think about the inverse of the elementary matrices for a purpose that will become clear only in a couple of slides. So let's think about the inverse. What does an inverse give you? Inverse basically is the opposite of what a matrix does. If A transforms X to B, then A inverse has to transform B back to X. That is my golden statement there. So similarly, we have to kind of think about the inverse of the elementary matrices. So if I'm swapping two rows, 2 and 3, what's its inverse? Inverse is the same. I'm going to swap the third and the second row again. If I swap it again, I'll get back to my original. That is my elementary matrix. So it's a simple operation. I'm doing the same thing twice. I get back to the original, swapping two rows. Such matrices for which the inverse is the same as the original, these matrices are called involutory. Involutory matrix is the one for which the inverse is the same as itself. Now, scaling a matrix, so the operation is R2 becomes 4 times R1. If I want to reverse it, what would I do? I'll take the second row and scale it by 1/4. So that is actually the inverse of the matrix. So this is my E2, scaling second row by 4. If I do the inverse, I just have to scale the second row by 1/4. The first row is 1 of first row, 0 of second row, 0 of third row. The second row of the product will become 0 of the first row, 1/4 of the second row, and then 0 of the third row. And the third row stays the same in the product. So that's what it does. Now, subtracting 3 times the first row from the third, the inverse of that will be adding 3 times the first row to the third one. So that was my elementary operator 3. The inverse is just changing the sign of that guy. Now, let's talk about a situation whereby we went from A to its row echelon form by just doing the third elementary operation, which is scaling and adding. No row exchanges. The elementary matrices will be of the kind E3 that we saw in the previous slide. Now, the product of lower triangular matrices is also a lower triangular matrix. The proof is very simple, the definition of a matrix product, and look at it. The inverse also is a lower triangular matrix, as we saw in the case of E3. All you had to do was just change the sign. What we will have will be a series of elementary operations, all of the third kind, elementary operations of the third kind, E1, E2, up to EK. All of them are lower triangular matrices. The product also is a lower triangular matrix. Its inverse also is a lower triangular matrix. So I will write A as E inverse times U, something like E times A is equal to U. If I multiply both sides by E inverse on the left, that's going to be E inverse U, and this guy is just identity matrix. So this is IA is equal to E inverse U. A is equal to E inverse U. E inverse is going to be a lower triangular matrix because each E that went into the product was lower triangular. So this can be written as LU. I'm just giving a different name for E inverse, knowing that is a lower triangular matrix. So that is the famous LU decomposition. L is like a bookkeeping mechanism which keeps track of all the row operations that went into it. What does it mean to say a matrix is lower triangular? A matrix like 0, 0, B, C, 0, D, E, F. This is lower triangular. This is a lower triangular matrix. Now, U can also be used to get the determinant because the third operation, the third ERO, does not change the determinant. And the determinant of U is very easy to compute because it's just the product of the diagonal elements. I am doing two operations here. I have my A here. I want to kill this guy and this guy. By killing, I mean I want to make those guys a zero. So I'll take the second row and subtract twice the first row from it. So the new second row will become minus 2 times row 1 plus the current row 2. The third row, I'll just subtract the first row from the third row. So that becomes minus R1 plus R3. By looking at it, I can write down the elementary matrix that the first row is not changing. So it's got 1 there. The second row is second row minus 2 times first row. I have a minus 2 there. The third row is minus 1 times the first row, nothing of the second row, and the third row. And if I want to do the inverse, I know that I just have to change the signs here. So that will be the same as changing the signs here. So I'll get that. After the first elementary operation, I get this guy. 2 became 0 and 1 became 0. But this guy is a 2 now because of the operation. I had to get rid of that. In order to get rid of that, I will use the second row. So R3 will be 2 times R2 plus R3. That will make this guy 0. So 2 times R2 plus R3, that will be the new R3. And nothing happens to the first row and the second row. And inverse of that is just a negative sign there. And so it's just changing the sign of this guy. Now, if I want to know L, I will have to take the inverse of E1 and E2. I took A, I multiplied by E1, and then I multiplied by E2. So I did two operations in that sequence. It is important. I have to keep track of the sequence. And this gave me U. And if I want to find A, I have to first multiply by E2 inverse. E1 times A is going to be E2 inverse times U. And then I want to take E1 also to the other side. So A becomes E1 inverse, E2 inverse, U. since matrix multiplication is not commutative, the order is important. So see that here I had E2, E1. There I have E1 inverse, E2 inverse. So that is something like the product rule of a matrix inverses, also similar to the transposes. So if I want to know L, I have to take E1 inverse, which was here, and multiply by that. Then you will get this. And U is the reduced matrix that you found here. So that is one decomposition. But we cleverly avoided doing the row swapping. But if you do have row exchanges, permutations, then we have a bit of an issue. Because if you look at the permutation matrix, they all have determinants plus or minus one. So if you have permutations, then life becomes a bit more complicated because you have a sign coming in. But you can always write A in the form of a permutation times a lower triangular matrix and upper triangular matrix. That is the general form. So P keeps track of row exchanges. But remember, the row exchanges, the matrices are not lower triangular matrices. But still, it is always possible to collect all the permutation matrices together. Always possible to group it that way. And if you had actually used a second elementary row operation also, then we would have to keep track of that also so that we can scale the final computation using that scaling factor also. But if you want to do determinants, nobody is going to use a second row operation because that's not needed.